Let's go. All right. So we've spent the last few months talking about salvation, all right? And we're building a foundation because what I want to talk about are some of the most important foundational aspects of our walk with God. And so when I started this, I felt like God said, take your time. And so I have been taking my time. And we may spend the rest of eternity building a foundation, all right? In Isaiah 28, it says that God builds line upon line and precept upon precept. And so we're going to add a new line and a new precept this morning, all right? But let's take a moment and kind of look at the foundation that we've been laying. And if you're interested, we've got about 9 weeks of messages that are on our website and on our YouTube channel at River of Love Community Church, and you can check them all out there. But Jesus is the Savior of the world. Amen? But most people don't have any idea why they need a Savior. We think that life is good, but compared with God's original design and God's original intent for man that he created with Adam and Eve in the beginning, we have lost absolutely everything. Okay? We are desperately lost. We have missed the original mark that God had set for man. And without someone to come and rescue us, deliver us, to set us free, to protect us, to keep us safe and sound, man, we are eternally lost. But the good news, the gospel, and if you're not aware, the word gospel actually means good news, all right? Like if you were watching the news and it said gospel, if we had gospel every night on TV at 6 o'clock, you would be tuning in to good news, all right? How many of you know we don't see the gospel at 6 o'clock? Amen. That's not the good news. But I'm telling you, the gospel, the letters that God wrote through Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and all of the epistles, I'm telling you, that is good news, all right? As a matter of fact, it's almost too good to be true, good news. And I'm just praying that God opens the eyes of our hearts so that we can begin to see that. Part of the good news is that we have a Savior. Aren't you glad? We have a rescuer, a deliverer, a protector, one who keeps us safe and sound, and his name is Jesus. Amen. The Bible says in John 3:16, for what God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him would not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that through the world, or that through him, the world would be saved. All right? That's why he's our Savior. Thank you, Adam. You won't disappear. I'm going to get 3 notifications. All right? So let me ask you this. What are some of the qualities of a Savior? I mean, we spent several weeks looking at what has been lost in the garden in the series that we did called Lost and Found. But when you think of a Savior, just in general terms, let's say that there's an accident out on the highway and or there's a house on fire. I mean, what are some of the attributes that an individual who is a Savior has? Bravery, okay. They've got bravery. Anything else? Strength. Sometimes superhuman strength in the midst of stuff like that. Yeah, Caleb? Selflessness. That is huge. That is so huge because what is one of the reasons that we don't stop and get involved? Many times is because it doesn't involve us personally and we live self-centered lives. But to the degree that we see the value of other people, we're willing to sacrifice our time and effort and to put ourselves in a position where it takes courage and we're willing to take risk in order to save someone, right? Any other characteristics that anybody wants to share? Well, those were all good, okay? Now, I'm going to add one more. How about empathy? I mean, the ability to to know where the other individual is and to relate to what they're going through, and that becomes a motivator to enter into a place where you're willing to save someone or to do the best you can to save someone. Amen. So who is our Savior? Jesus, right? Do you think that he has all of those attributes? Do you think he empathizes with our situation? Do you believe that he's selfless? Do you believe that he's courageous? He's all that and more, all right? Our Savior is Almighty God himself. And I'm hoping that before this message is over that you have a revelation of Almighty God like you have never had before. The Creator of everything loves you so much that he could not leave you in a fallen state. He had to make a way of escape, all right? There had to be a way for us to be rescued from this entrapment of sin that caused us to be on a path that was just leading to death, all right? 1 Corinthians 10:13, you can look at this one if you want. It says this, that no temptation has taken or overtaken you, but such as is common to man. But God will not allow you to be tempted beyond that which you are able, but he will make a way of escape. How many of you know that's true? From the very beginning, even when Adam and Eve were tempted in the garden, they were not tempted beyond that which they were able. And there was a way of escape, and there is a way of escape. Let me tell you that the way of escape is not something, the way of escape is someone, all right? The way of escape, many times, man, I've been in the middle of a situation, I said, man, I've got to find the way of escape, and I'm looking around at circumstances, I'm looking around waiting on something to change, and I don't recognize that my way of escape isn't something, it's someone. Jesus is our way of escape. In John chapter 14, verse 6, Jesus said, I am the way. I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. John 10:9, I am the door. If anyone enters through me, he will be saved. See, Jesus is the way of escape for each and every one of us, all right? So what I want to do this morning is do a kind of get to know you about our Savior. Is that all right? How many of you like get to know yous? All right, aren't they fun, Ed? He's got that look, yeah. I don't know anybody that can comprehend the greatness of our God. I don't know anyone who can comprehend his love, his mercy, his power, his majesty. I think that we try to get a glimpse, but I don't think that we ever get close, you know? There's a man, his name, I don't know if you've heard of him, Blaise Pascal. He was a 16th century mathematician. Yeah. But he had this famous quote that I found this week, and he says, you know, God created us in his image, and we've returned the compliment. In other words, we've created God in our image. We have taken the almighty, omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent, omnibenevolent God, and we have reduced him to an image and a likeness that we can comprehend. I'll tell you, we are missing something when we try to put God in a box. God is too big for any box that you can try to contain. He is so big, so awesome, beyond anything that you could ask, think, or imagine. I want to read a couple of verses for you because there are individuals who have wrote about God and their wonderful amazement at who God is and how much he loves us. In the prophet Isaiah, verse 55, verses 8 and 9, Isaiah writes, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, Nor are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, and we're going to get a revelation of that this morning, as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. We quote that verse, but man, I'll tell you what, today I want God to give you a revelation of what it means for his ways to be so beyond our ways, his ways to be so higher than ours, as high as the heavens are from the earth. In Isaiah 40, verse 28, do you not know, have you not heard the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, does not become weary or tired. His understanding is uncomprehensible. Okay? That's what it says in the King James Version. His understanding is incomprehensible. Psalms 147, verse 5. Great is our Lord and abundant in strength. His understanding is infinite. Man. And then Psalm 145, verse 3, great is the Lord and highly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable. Can you imagine living your life where you always lived in amazement of how great and how big and how awesome, how powerful, how mighty, how wise is our God? Man, if we really had a revelation of how big God is, I don't think that we would have a worry or a care about anything. The thing is that we've reduced God down to our size. We've reduced him to our knowledge or realm of understanding. We've limited him to the extent that we know and understand him, which is relatively small. And so we pray and then we start looking for help. Man, I'll tell you, nothing wrong with looking for help, but where does our help come from? Our help comes from God, the maker of heaven and earth. He is a great, great God. When you think about God as your Savior, you've got to understand that he outrageously exceeds anything that you could ever think or imagine. Hallelujah. I've been meditating on this throughout the week, and God is just like, he's gotten bigger and bigger. He just is. I mean, I just think of the places where I have limited God in my own understanding, and God has just blown all of that up for me this week. When you get a glimpse of how, or we begin to get a glimpse of how big God is when we look at his creation, okay? In Romans 1, verse 20, Paul is writing his letter to the Romans, who are Gentiles and don't understand the ways of God. And he says this, he says, for since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, his eternal power, and his divine nature have been clearly seen and understood through that which has been made. So we begin to understand the greatness and the bigness of our God by looking at his creation, right? Okay. And in John chapter 1, verse 1, it says this, because we get a picture of how big God is by looking at the beginning. I'm a baseball fan, and they always say that God was into baseball because this was the beginning, right? The beginning. All right. Oh, boy. So follow me. All right. It says that in the beginning was the Word. All right. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. And listen, verse 3, all things came into being through him. And apart from him, nothing came into being that has come into being. God is the beginning. Everything begins with God. There is nothing that exists that does not have its beginning in God. All right? So I've got this little video that I want to show you this morning that just, when I looked at this, it just began to open my eyes to the absolute amazement of how great our God is. When we try to put him into a box, man, I'll tell you what, he's getting ready to explode that box like you've never seen before. There are a couple of terms. You're going to begin to get a picture of what we can only comprehend. And remember, God is incomprehensible, all right? So we're going to get a picture, a macro or a big picture of the creation of God, and we're going to get a micro. We're going to get a very small picture of the detail that God put in his creation. And it's absolutely amazing. So I want to show this video, and at the bottom of the video, there's a little arrow that begins to show you what the timeline is. And so we're going to start in the present, and we're going to stretch out from where we are to about 10 billion light years. All right? And then we're going to come back, and we're going to get so small, we're going to move into something that I never even heard of before. Does anybody know what a femtometer is? A femtometer is. We'll talk about that in a minute, but you're going to see one, all right? So, Charles, are you ready to show that video? This is cool. That's 10 meters, 100 meters. That amazing? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was formless and void, and darkness was over the surface of the deep. And the Spirit of God was moving over the waters, over the surface of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light." Everything that has been created has been created by the word of God. God spoke the word. He didn't say, let there be light, he said, light be. And the power and the majesty and the omnipotence of God went into operation. And God's creation was manifest in a moment. You talk about a big bang. I'm sure that was a big bang. But you know what's interesting? We saw the universe there, and it is not until verse 14 and 16 on day 4 that God said, let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years, and let them be for lights in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth, and it was so. So God made the two great lights, the greater light to govern the day and the lesser light to govern the night. Oh, and by the way, he made the stars also. Everything that God made was made because of you. Everything that was created to hold and to hold together this little speck called the earth. I want to put some perspective to this, because when I looked at this, I'm looking at numbers and I said, God, I need something to begin to comprehend this with. So a light year is the distance that light can travel in a year. All right. We all know what it's like to go 75 mile an hour, right? But light travels at 5,888,000,000 miles a year. All right. And again, that's just a word. What does a trillion look like? Does anybody have a picture that can explain what a trillion looks like? A trillion is like a stack of $100 bills that are 40 million inches high, which is about 631 miles. That's a picture of a million. A stack of $100 bills, 631 miles high. How would you like to win that in the lottery? I don't even know how to put a value to that. And so the earth, the galaxy that we saw at 10 billion light years, to find out how many miles that is, you would have to take 10 billion times 5,888,000,000,000 to get an answer. I can't even comprehend that. And still the greatness and the magnitude of our God exceeds our understanding. Now, this little thing called a femtometer, all right, that's going to be our word for today. Okay, Fred? Femtometer. Can you all say femtometer? Femtometer. See, now you all know a new word, all right? A femtometer is 1/4 of a meter. Okay, and a meter is about a yard, approximately, okay? It's a quadrillionth. It's like 1 to the 15th power, or 1 with like 15 zeros after it, all right? So when you look at the amazement of God's creation, we not only see the detail of how large and expanding the heavens are, but we also see the detail and the intricateness of how the human body has been put together. And you know what's even more amazing than that? Just to see how big and amazing God's creation is, not only does it exist, but all of this creation has to exist in a perfectly balanced proportion that has to exist in order for life to be sustained. It's not just random. Everything in our entire universe and our body was designed by Almighty God, and it has to be in a certain way in order for us to sustain life. There's a website called reasons.org. This is where I get some of this information, okay? Reasons.org. And they defined 322 parameters that have to be perfectly and harmoniously exist to sustain life. 322 distinct and different parameters that have to exist together harmoniously in order for life to exist. You know what the chances of that just happening randomly on its own? Anybody want to take a guess? What's the biggest number that you can think of?
Gazillion.
The possibility is 10 to the 322nd power. Okay. And an analogy that would put that in perspective, it's like buying one lottery ticket. All right, one lottery ticket and winning the lottery every day for 150 consecutive days. God is an awesome God. There is no way that we just evolved into what we are. God is awesome. God is, he's bigger than anything that we could ever imagine. He created all of this by his word, and he sustains it by his word, all right? And what's amazing to me, in John chapter 1, verse 14, it says this, and the word, the macro, awesome, great bigness of God that is beyond our comprehension, became flesh and dwelt among us. Man, that is awesome. The bigness of God became the smallness of man because he loves you. And he wants to have a deep and abiding relationship with you forever. You know, it's not like just going to work and finding a buddy that's going to be a good friend. When we say Jesus is my Savior, Do you recognize the awesomeness of who our God is and the price that he paid in the universe that he created in order for you and I to be saved? That's amazing. In Philippians chapter 3, verse 2, I'm looking at some of these verses in a different light, you know. It says in verse 6 of Philippians chapter 2, who although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but he emptied himself. He emptied himself, taking the form of a bondslave. And being made in the likeness of man, in the appearance of man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Think about the awesomeness of God who created 10 billion light years. He emptied himself of all of his glory and became a man. And the reason that he became a man is because he loves you. He took the form not only of a man, but of a servant. And he became obedient to his Father to the point of death. Death on a cross, one of the most excruciating deaths that one can experience. The God of the universe loves you so much that he left the throne room of heaven and became a man because he saw the state that we were in when Adam and Eve ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and said, I'm going to make a way of escape. Remember, the way of escape isn't something, it's someone. And Jesus will go to no end. God will go to no end to be the way of escape for you. No matter what it takes. If he has to speak a word that creates something so large that it's 10 billion light years, and that's just the beginning, God will do that and more to meet all of your needs. Philippians says he will meet all of your needs according to his riches. Do you get a picture of that? The riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. Woo! And you know what? In John chapter 17, Almighty God says that now I call you friends. I call you friends. I'll tell you what. When I was growing up, I was so glad that I had a big buddy. You know, if somebody was messing with me, I knew I had a big brother that would look out for me. Guess who you have? Almighty God looking out after you. So we have a Savior, and He has invited us into a personal relationship with Him. And not only that, but when you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, recognizing that we are so lost from God's original design and intent, and He restored every bit of it through Jesus Christ, and then He came and decided to make His home, not on some out planet way out in the galaxy. God Almighty decided to take up His residence and tabernacle inside of you. That's why the Bible says that the same power that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you. Man, if we could ever get a revelation of that, man, you look at sickness, you look at disease, you look at financial need, and you begin to see the bigness and the greatness of God. And in light of how awesome God is, everything becomes strangely dim and unimportant. God is so great. What are the takeaways that we need to take from this morning? Just a few. This week, I want you to begin to think about God in the context of who He really is. I want you to allow God to become bigger for you than He's ever been before. This isn't imaginary, folks. We have just got a glimpse of the awesomeness, the greatness, the bigness. And in the coming weeks, we're going to begin to look at the omnipotence, the omniscience, the omnipresence, and the omnibenevolence of God and get even a clearer picture, all right? It's important for us to know who our Savior is. So I want you to begin to meditate and to begin to think about God in the context of who He is. There is no rival, okay? Is there anything that you are facing that is too big for God to save you from? Is there anything that you're facing that God can't deliver you from? Is there any sickness that God can't heal you from? Is there any situation that you're in that God can't protect you? Is there any place in your life that God can't make you whole? Think about that. This week, let's begin to look beyond our circumstances and see the God who says, I am your way of escape. And when our eyes are opened, and instead of looking to our bank account, instead of looking at our own natural abilities, when we begin to look at Almighty God and begin to look to Him as our way of escape, you're looking in the right direction. How many of you need to change your focus a little bit? I sure have. All right. So, and then finally, let's make God the center of our universe in the same way that God has made us the center of His universe. Do you know that He or that you are the apple of God's eye? You are exceedingly precious. What is it? You know, God. Yeah. That's what I'm trying to say. This is from our Wednesday night class. But God is especially fond of you. Sometimes I think we just need to take time to think about that. You can say that, but my prayer is that God opens the eyes of our heart this morning. And we begin to grasp the awesomeness of the one that we call my Savior. Amen. Let's stand here this morning. I wanted to kind of end the service by singing a song. I wanted to sing the song, How Great is Our God. And as we sing this song, as we close this morning, I want you to just open up your heart and allow, as you're singing the song, the greatness of God to just fill your heart and fill your spirit. Because I believe that as you get a revelation of who He is, that even as we're singing, God, how great you are, you know, that God will, man, He can heal you as we sing this song. He can change the circumstances in your life. Our God is an awesome God. There is no other God like Him. We have made Him in our own image. We've reduced Him to wooden idols and other things, but man, that's just not God. We need to worship Him in spirit and in truth. Are we ready to sing this song? Okay, let's hit it. Let's sing, How Great is Our God.
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps Himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at His voice, trembles at His voice.